Hello and welcome everyone to the course Industrial Robotics and Automation. In today's lecture, we'll be starting our new module. And this module is actually dedicated to your electro-pneumatic systems. Okay. The previous module, we had actually learned about the introduction to the automation and our pneumatic as well as hydraulic systems and your pneumatic and hydraulic circuit designs. Okay, in this, we will continue with the electro-pneumatic systems and then further go on to the electro-pneumatic circuit designs. Okay. So, before proceeding further, let us see how these signal flows, okay, in a normal, just in a normal control system. Okay. Only then, when we will compare it to our pneumatic system, then we will see where the difference lies, okay, in the electro-pneumatic or an electro-hydraulic system. Okay. So what is a signal? Okay. It is actually a representation of information by means of some values, okay, which represents a physical variable. Okay, fine. These signals can be either your digital signal, okay, binary also a specific case of digital signal where you either have your 0 or a 1, only two outputs, okay, only two values are there, either in 0 or in 1. Or in a normal case, you can say either it is a switch on or a switch off circuit. Okay, so only two types of when a digital is actually reduced to only two types of signals, it is known as binary. And then finally, you will be having your analog signals. Okay, so most of the signals that we had till now, okay, covered in our pneumatic circuit or in hydraulic circuits, they were all a binary signals. Okay, that means either you had a flow of pilot pressure line at the output, or you do not have a flow. Okay, so nothing as such as digital. Okay, because in digital, you although they are in discrete steps, but you have more than two values. Say if you are measuring a temperature between, say, suppose 10 to 20 degrees Celsius. Okay, and you are getting an digital signal for every degree of Celsius of temperature. Okay, say for example 10, 11, 12. Okay, so these are actually discrete values, and 10 discrete values you'll be getting between 10 to 20. Okay, if you are trying to keep a difference between all these values to be as one. Okay, fine. And then you also have a analog signal, which is more of a continuous in nature. That means you can have infinite amount of signals, okay, between any specified range. Fine. So let us see, the picture to the right actually shows you the flow of signal in a control system. We had also seen this picture earlier also. So if you see from the bottom, okay, you have your signal input here, okay, and then these signal input is actually processed. Okay, so that means your processing of the signal is there. Once the signal is processed, only then you have an output. Okay, and that is also that output actually commands a certain amount of work to be done, okay, which actually results in your command execution time. Okay, so now comparing it to your pneumatic circuit, say, okay, so what are the input elements in that? Suppose if you see, it will be your manually operated valves, okay, because all your valves in your pneumatic circuit, they were your manually operated, you were doing it push button type, or you also had a mechanically operated using your roller valves or all these types of elements. So those were your input elements. Then you have your signal processing element in between, okay, in which you do all your logical operations. For example, we used a dual pressure valve for doing your AND type of logic, and then we used a shuttle valve for executing an OR type of logic. So all these things were done. That means we were processing those signals. Okay, so whatever signals we were getting in the form of your pilot lines from say two push button valve, okay, so these two lines we were actually doing the processing of these signals, either using an AND valve or an OR valve. Okay, and then finally, where did we send the signal to? After your signal processing, we sent it to a pneumatically operated valve. Okay, so it was a 5x2 or a 5x3 or a 3x2 way valve. Okay, depending upon whether you are actually operating a single acting cylinder or a double acting cylinder as your command execution step. Okay, so if you see in this diagram here, your input, your processing, and your signal output, okay, they all form the signal control section. Okay, whereas your command execution, okay, that means your extension of the cylinder using a pressurized line, okay. Say in case of a hydraulic, it is a pressurized oil, and in case of pneumatic, it is compressed gas. So that section is actually your power section. Fine. So this is the way in which your signal flows. Okay. Now let us see, where this pneumatic and where the electro pneumatic systems differ in case of your signal control section. Okay. So if you see, both pneumatic and electro pneumatic controllers have a pneumatic power section. That means both will be having a power section. Okay. That means both will involve your cylinders, your actuators, be it your rotary actuators or your linear actuators that are powered by your compressed gas in case of pneumatic, or a pressurized oil in case of your hydraulic systems. Okay. However, the signal control section will vary, okay, depending upon whether it is a pneumatic circuit or a electro pneumatic or an electro hydraulic circuit. Fine. So in a pneumatic control, what were the pneumatic components that we used for the signal control elements? We used different types of valves, okay. And then in an electro pneumatic control, what would the signal control section consist of? Instead of having pneumatic components, okay, it will actually consist of electrical components. For example, your push button valve will get replaced by your say normally open switch or a normally closed switch, okay. So they will all be carrying electrical signals. Fine. Whereas if you compare this to an pneumatic control, we were actually having pneumatic components. That means your signal input elements, if you just compare, it was a 3x2 say manually operated valve. So what were the output of the valve? You were getting actually your pneumatic pressure. So your entire signal, okay, was in case of a pneumatic pressure, where you controlled all those things, okay, you process the signal, and the final output of the signal was also a pneumatic pressure, which was used to turn the which was used to shift the spool of a 5x2 or a 5x3 or say suppose a 3x2 valve that was solenoid operated, okay. That means both, sorry, not solenoid operated, it was pneumatically pilot pressure operated. So that means the signal was actually your pneumatic signals. Whereas in case of an electro pneumatic control, all these things will be a electrical signals, okay. And then these signals are finally processed either using your relays or your PLCs, which we will be again studying in the next module. And then you will see finally it will execute your signal output, okay. Here in this case, the signal output will be again a 5x2 valve, but it will be a solenoid operated valve instead of a double pilot operated valve, okay. So your final, your direction control valves, okay, that is actually forms an interface between the two, both say your signal control section as well as your power section. Okay. So when you will be seeing in details, okay, when we draw the electro pneumatic circuit, and then when we'll compare it with the pneumatic circuits, we will see how these direction control valves, okay, actually forms an interface between your power section and your pneumatic control section or your electro pneumatic control section in case of a pneumatic or your electro pneumatic circuits. Fine. So again, this pictures we had actually discussed in our earlier class also. So if you see, if we compare, this is actually a signal flow, okay, or a pneumatic control system, okay, for a this is a signal flow for a pneumatic section. So if you see again the same pictures having a signal input, signal processing, signal output, and your command execution. Now if you just try to compare the different components that we used in a pneumatic control system and how these signal was processed, okay, finally, and was finally given as a signal output to execute my final my power component, that was your pneumatic cylinder or your pneumatic say motors, okay. So if you see in the input elements, we actually had your mechanically operated or your manually operated direction control valves, okay. So if you see here, this is a 3x2 push button valve, okay. So ultimately these valves, what are they giving us signals into? They are actually giving you pneumatic signals, okay. So that means the signal input is actually again a pneumatic signal, that is a pressurized line. Then again you have your signal processing using a dual pressure valve or your shuttle valve. Again in this case your pneumatic signals are getting processed, okay. Finally, you are also getting a signal output in terms of a pneumatic signal, okay, which actually shifts the spool of a DCV using a pilot operated valve. Fine. And these valves finally execute your extension or the retraction of a cylinder in case of a linear actuators, or a clockwise or anti-clockwise motion of your rotary actuators. Fine. So that means I told you, like in the rotary actuators, if you put one side of the valve again, then you will be having a circular motion, and then if you engage the other envelope of the DCV, then you will be having a counterclockwise, okay, motion. So either you rotate it in a clockwise or you rotate it into an anti-clockwise motion, okay. And if you see, look closely here, okay, so this is a final control element, that is a direction control valve, which is actually being an interface, okay, between your pneumatic signal control and your pneumatic power section, okay. So this is the interface here. Now compare this with an electro-pneumatic control, okay. So even in the electro-pneumatic control, you will be seeing that this is a direction control valve, although in the earlier case it was a pilot operated, okay, both sides double pilot operated, 5/2 DCV here. In this case it is a 5/2 DCV, but it is a solenoid valve, okay, because why? It will process the electrical signal. So the all the signals that is coming from the electro-pneumatic control system, that is your electrical signal control, they are all processed, and finally you are getting an output here as an electrical signal, which in turn this actually valves will be shifting these spools, okay, within your this valve, and then your power section, that is your pneumatic controls, okay, elements, they will all remain the same even in case of your electro-pneumatic sections, okay. So now let us just read about your different types of input elements, your processing elements, as well as your output elements that will form my or that will be a part of my electrical signal control of my electro-pneumatic systems, okay. So when we talk about the signal input, of course, since this is an electrical signals, your all your input elements will be your push button or your control switches, then different type of sensors, okay, your proximity sensors, your capacitive, inductive, as well as your optical sensors, okay, all these things combined, okay, will be forming your input signals, and then those signals will be processed through relays and your PLCs. Finally, you will be giving an output, okay, and that output will be what? Shifting of the spool of your final control element valve, okay. And in this case, that shifting will be done using a solenoid valve, okay, so that your electrical signal is actually processed and the spools are shifted using your some amount of voltage, okay, that will be required. And then finally, your actuation or your command execution is actually taking place using your pneumatic systems itself, okay. So in today's class, we'll be discussing in details about all these signal input elements, okay, what are the different type of signal input elements, your signal processing, as well as your signal output elements, okay. So once we are able to see what are the different types of these signal input and processing as well as output elements, then we will put them in use to make a electro-pneumatic circuit. So fine. Now when we talk about an electro-pneumatic circuit, we are going to have two separate circuit diagrams as compared to a single circuit diagram that was there in case of a pneumatic system, okay. So if you can just recall your different circuit diagrams that you drew for your pneumatic system, different types of practice problems that we did, we had only one circuit diagram in which your all your valves and this, they all were all a part of a pneumatic circuit. Since your all your control elements and the input elements, they were all pneumatic in nature. Whereas in case of an electro-pneumatic controller, if you see here, it will consist of two circuit, okay. One will be for an electrical part, okay, and the other two will be for a pneumatic part, okay. So now let us just take an example here. For example, see, this is a direction control valve, okay, if you see here, and this is a solenoid operated direction control valve, okay. So to extend this cylinder again, then this cylinder, what it would have, this cylinder will get extended and retracted using a pneumatic pressure, okay, or your hydraulic pressure. So that means if you see these ports, okay, one port will be there as an inlet port to this, and one port will be there to as an outlet port to so that the liquid is drained during the extension, okay, and vice versa during the retraction port, in which your this port will act like a pressurized port and this will act like a drain port. So that means this circuit shown by dark line here, that will actually form a part of your pneumatic circuit. However, if you want to detect the end positions of these cylinders, okay, then of course if you see, these are having proximity switches here, okay. So these proximity switches are your sensors, okay, here they are actually working on an electrical signal, in which depending upon, okay, the input signals here, they will all, these are all electrical signals which are actually processed through a signal control element, and finally the command execution, okay, or your signal output is again in the form of a electrical signal here, which actually comes and says that, okay, this is your electrical output here in the form of, say, suppose 24 volt connection here, which will actually result in the actuation of this solenoid, okay, which consists of your, again, electromagnet circuit, which will energize the core, and it will try to shift the spool within this valve, okay, leading to either the extension of the cylinder. And once the cylinder has completely extended, then again you will be having this proximity sensors that will detect your end position and again send a signal back, okay, which will get processed and finally tell this solenoid valve now to the other side of the 5x2 valve here to shift this spool to the other side of the valve so that your cylinder starts retracting. So that means you will be having two circuit diagrams, okay, one will be your all your electrical circuit diagrams, okay, having all your electrical input elements, your processing elements, okay, and your the other part will be your power section, that means comprising of your pneumatic cylinders, okay, your valves, as well as your power source, okay, be it in the case of a pneumatic, it will be your compressor, or in hydraulic, it may again be your pump, okay. So now, as I told you, we will be now going into details of each and every small components that will be used in the electrical signal control. Fine, so yes, so if you see, if you just compare here, so we will start with the signal input elements, okay. So what are the input elements? Fine, and then next we will go to your processing elements, okay, that is your relays, and then finally we will be discussing about the control elements, okay. So all these things will be specific to your electro-pneumatic circuit, fine. So your components of your electrical signal control, okay, that is your input components, starts with your push button as well as your control switches, okay, fine. So what are switches? Switches are installed in the circuits to apply a current to a load or to interrupt the circuit, okay. So these switches again are further divided into either your push button type of switches or your control switches. The control switches are detented, okay, or retentive in nature, that means whenever your position is engaged, okay, that position will not change until unless you do not switch it to a new position, okay. For example, your light switches at home, okay, so that means once you switch it on, it will remain in an off position until you do not switch it off. Similarly, your push buttons, okay, it has only momentarily applications, okay. For example, the switches are actuated only for a small amount of time, and those actuation is only till when you are keeping your push button pressed, okay, just like your bell switch, fine. Now the even in these type of switches, whether you are using a push button switch or you are using a normal your control switches, in both cases, okay, they are either of your normally open contact type or they are of the normally closed contact type, okay. So in case of a normally open contact, what is it? Okay, the circuit is open if the switch is in its initial position, okay. So if you see here, this is a symbolic representation of here, and this is the actual switch element, okay, the schematic diagram of it. So initially this these contacts, okay, or this circuit is open. If you see, there is this circuit is broken here, okay. So it's they do not have any contacts, okay, fine. Now once you press the either a push button type of circuit or your control switches, okay, then what would happen? It would result in my circuit getting engaged, okay, and the current would start to flow. So that means the moment I press this downward, you see the current will now start to flow through this contact. And if you see the symbolic representation is here, normally it is open here. The moment I press this, then my again current would start to flow from your this line here, okay. And this specifically is a symbol for a push button type of circuit here, okay. That means it is an open contact and it is a push button here, fine. Now in a normally closed contact, what we see, the circuit is closed when the switch is in its initial position, and once you engage it, okay, by pressing the push button, then it will interrupt the circuit. If you see here, initially the circuit is closed, that means initially you have your current flowing through this path here, okay. Whenever you are actuating it through the push button, okay, the symbol of the push button being here, then the circuit would be interrupted, okay, or the circuit would become open. So in its initial condition, it is a closed circuit which allows the passage of current, and the moment you energize or you press the push button, then the circuit would break, fine. Then also you have a third category in it, which is known as your changeover contact, okay. So basically changeover contact, it combines the functionality of both normally open as well as your normally controlled devices, okay. That means you have both normally open as well as your normally closed contacts here, okay. So this is actually used to close one circuit and open other circuit, okay, in one type of switching operation. You must have seen at your home, okay, when you are those of you all who have diesel gensets at your home, you must be seeing there is a changeover switch, okay, near your at any place of your house, so that whenever your electricity goes off and you switch on your genset, okay, what you do, you actually change over the contact. That means you are changing the contact from your regular power supply to your genset mode, okay. So what happens, see, suppose this, in this case, say suppose this was the connection of your normal power supply, okay, that is having. Now in case of a power failure, okay, that means you do not have any supply here and you switch on your genset, then what you will do, you will actually engage it to your other contact here. That means now you will be having a line, okay, coming from your port number 4, not port, the connection number 4 here, and then so what you will do, you will just change over. If it is a if it is only a push button type, then it would do a momentary change till when you are pushing it up, okay. But however, if it is a switch type of element, then the change would be permanent unless you don't change it back, okay, to its original position, okay. So that means you are actually changing the circuit, okay, from one part of the circuit to the other part. That means you are actually switching the entire control from your normal electric power supply to your diesel genset power supply. Okay, fine. So these are your changeover contacts, fine. So after the all your different type of your input elements, the second important part are your sensors, okay. So sensors also form a part of your input element. Why? Because see, based on something that they are sensing, okay, they give certain amount of information that is need to be further processed, okay, before a command for a particular output is given. So sensors are also actually part of your input elements, okay. Now specifically in a electro-pneumatic control, okay, or in an electro-pneumatic circuit, we generally use sensors for either measuring your displacement or your position and your pressures, okay. So I'm sure you must have studied in detail the different types of sensors, okay, and during your other modules, okay, that was covered by Professor Arun. So here I will be just be doing a just quick recap, okay, of the different types of sensors that we'll be using here in an electro-pneumatic circuit, okay, fine. So in electro-pneumatic circuit, we actually use sensors, okay, either to detect the advanced as well as the retracted position of linear actuators, that is your cylinders here. In other applications, we also we use to detect the presence of or a position of some workpiece. For example, if a workpiece is moving in a conveyor belt, okay, so when it reaches a particular location, I may have a sensor to detect whether the workpiece has reached to that location or not. So, okay, so it detects the either the presence of a workpiece at a certain position or your the exact position of the workpiece. Okay, fine. So, and the third, we actually, since we are working either in a pneumatic or in hydraulic range, then it is usually used to measure your pressure, okay, in the line, because many of the activities that we'll do, it will depend upon the pressure that is there in the circuits, okay. So, these are your different types of sensors that we technically use when we confine our discussions to our electro-pneumatic circuits only, okay. Otherwise, you have a variety of sensors. Fine. So, to detect your position or your distance, first type of sensors, okay, that we use is your limit switch. Fine. So, what is a switch? It is actuated when a machine part or a workpiece is in a certain position. Normally, the actuation is affected by a cam. That means you have a physical contact. Okay. So, again, even the limit switches, okay, it can either be a normally open type of contact or a normally closed or a changeover contact. If you see here, just like your, if you compare it to your pneumatic circuit, it is a type of a roller valve. Okay. So, if you just recall, what was your roller valve? So, whenever your cylinder extended, okay, then when your piston rod actually touched the roller valve, then you had a pneumatic signal. Okay, that was used either to change the position of a pilot controlled DCVs. Okay. In this case, what would happen? Again, you are having a cam operated roller valve here itself. But then the signal, instead of being your pneumatic signal, in this case, it will be an electrical signal. Fine. So again, since it is an electric signal, then again, your contacts, you can either have a normally open contact or a normally closed contact, or you can also have a changeover contact. For example, if you recall, you had a roller valve in a normally closed configuration, and you also had a roller valve in a normally open valve type of configuration. Okay. So in case of a normally open configuration, if you recall, you had a pneumatic port, okay, that was a pressurized port was connected to your outlet port in the default position, and whenever your valve was actuated, that port was blocked, okay. And in case of a normally closed contact, initially that pressurized port was closed, and whenever your roller valve was engaged, then you had a pilot signal flowing, okay, at the output. So similar is the case here, okay. Instead of, but only the difference is that instead of having a pneumatic signal, we are working here with an electrical signal. Fine. Then we come to your proximity sensors. Okay. So see, if you see your limit switch, you have to have a mechanical contact here. Okay. Fine. So when we work in the proximity range sensors, when we do not have any contact between the two, then generally we give a term known as your proximity sensors. That means in contrast to the limit switches, these proximity sensors operate contactlessly. That means they do not have any contact switching. Okay, the switching is non-contact, okay, without any external mechanical actuating force. Okay, as a result, okay, these proximity sensors have a long service life, okay, and a very high switching reliability. Fine. So they are, since we will just limit our discussion to these three types of sensors that we'll be extensively using our in our electro-pneumatic circuit design. Okay, fine. So there are like inductive type, capacitive type, as well as optical type of proximity sensors, which will of course have three electrical contacts. So the first contact will be of your voltage supply. Okay. The second one will be your ground. And the third contact will be your output signal. Okay, so whenever the output signal will be giving a 0 volt, okay, signal when nothing is detected in its proximity. But if anything is detected in its proximity, then what will happen? The output signal will be equal to your supply voltage signal. Okay, so that means the voltage and your supply voltage and your ground will always remain there. Okay, but you will get an output signal only when there is a certain objects that has been detected in the vicinity of the proximity sensors. Fine. We'll be going into the detail of these sensors, okay, your connection of the sensors when we do the circuit design for the electro-pneumatic portion. Fine. And then again, in these sensors, we have your positive and your negative switching sensors. This you can draw your analogy just to your normally closed and your normally open type of switches. For example, in a positive switching sensor, okay, the output voltage is zero if no part is detected in the proximity sensors. Okay, the approach of a workpiece or a machine part will lead to the switchover of the output, okay, applying the supply voltage. That means it will just be like a normally closed switch. Okay, that means initially you do not have any output signal. Okay, the output voltage is zero. Okay, in this part, in your contact for your output signal, so that is zero. But whenever it detects something, okay, then they will be giving a some amount of, that is the voltage will be, the output voltage will be the same as that of a supply voltage whenever something is detected in its vicinity. Whereas in case of a negative switching sensors, okay, initially the supply voltage is equal to that of your output voltage is equal to that of the supply voltage. However, whenever something is detected in its vicinity, then again your switching output will be your zero volt. Okay, it is just like your, you can do the analogy to that of a normally open and your normally contact type of switches. Fine. After that, I told you there are pressure sensors also. So I'm just giving you one example. Although there are different type of sensors that we use here, even for measuring or to detect the pressure. So this I'm just showing you a mechanical pressure switch here. So that means in the mechanically actuated pressure switch, if you see, the pressure acts on the cylinder surface. Okay, so the pressure acts here, right? If the pressure exceeds the spring force, okay, of the return spring. So here you can have your, you can tune in your spring force. So if this pressure exceeds your spring force, then what would happen? This will lead to your movement of this cam type of mechanism here, which would again lead to your closing of this contact. Okay, so that means if you see, initially it is a open contact, but the moment this will shift, this will actually close the circuit. So it would actually send an electrical signal once your required pressure or your pressure that is there flowing in a pipeline is equal to the pressure that you have set that is to be detected. Fine. Then you have your signal processing units. Okay, and in an electro-pneumatic circuit, fine, you will be doing it exclusively with the help of relays. And in case of a PLC, okay, again, then of course you will be processing all these signals using the programmable logic controllers. Okay, so specifically in the electro-pneumatic circuit, we'll be doing it with relay. Now, what is the relay? A relay, if you see, okay, this is a schematic diagram here. Okay, fine. So it is a relay is an electromechanically actuated switch. Okay, so you have an electromagnet here where you have your armature currents, okay, flowing through it. So this A1 and A2 is actually your symbols for your armature currents. Okay, so when a voltage is applied to the solenoid coil, what would happen? An electromagnetic field results. This causes the armature to be attracted to the coil core. So this is an armature. The moment you supply in your some amount of voltage here, okay, and then this gets energized and your armature will become will behave like a magnet. Okay, and it will try to attract this, okay, contact coil here. Okay, so what would happen? The armature actuates the relay contacts. So when this attracts, if you see here, this entire armature is actually connected to different type of circuits here. If you see 1, 2, and 4, so all these symbols and your naming we will be discussing in detail. Right now just see, this is like one type of contact. So the moment this gets pulled, okay, then what would happen? This would actually lead to your contact of this circuit. Okay, so 1 to 4. Now see, in one case of in one relay you can have multiple contacts. Okay, say suppose when this is pulled, okay, when this is pulled by the electromagnet, what would happen? This entire plate, if it has suppose 10 circuits here, okay, individual circuit, if you see, this is 1 1 1 2 and 1 4. Similarly you have 2 1 2 2 2 4. Similarly you may have 3 1 3 2 3 4. Okay, and then 4 1 4 2 4 4, depending upon how many types of normally open contacts you have and how many types of normally closed contacts you have. Okay, so if suppose there are 5 normally open contacts and 5 normally closed contacts that are attached to this relay, so whenever this relay is actuated, okay, then all those 5 normally open contacts will close. Okay, and those contacts that were normally closed will open. Okay, so that is the function of a relay. You will understand it in more detail, okay, when we are drawing the or when we are making the pneumatic the electro-pneumatic circuit diagrams. Fine. Then finally you have your signal output elements. What were your signal output elements? It was your solenoid operated valve, okay, or your electrically actuated DCVs. Fine. So they actually form the link between your power section, that is your pneumatic cylinder and your compressor, okay, which actually leads to the extension and retraction when it passes, when the air passes through these DCVs, okay, electrically actuated DCVs. However, your control signals are electrical control signals. That is why instead of having two pilot ports at the two ends of your final control valve, okay, in case of a pneumatic circuit, you will be having two solenoids at the end of your valve, okay, in case of an electro-pneumatic circuit, because once all your input elements are processed, okay, using the signal processing step, and then your final output element will be in the form of an electrical current that will be supplied to your, or your voltage that will be supplied to your solenoid valve, and then your solenoid valve will be your interface, okay, between your finally your pneumatic power section, that is your cylinder extending or retracting, and your electrical control signal. Fine. So let us see what are those control, finally your electrically actuated DCVs, how do they form. So if you see here in this picture, this is the actuation of a single acting cylinder. So this is your power source section, okay. So initially, say if the cylinder is retracted, this is a 3x2 valve. If you see, these are the three ports, 1, 2 and 3. So initially this port is blocked, and then you have your one end of your pneumatic cylinder, okay, the drain port, right now this port being connected to your drain port, and your air or your liquid is getting drained and your cylinder is in its retracted position. Now if you have to extend the cylinder, okay, finally what would happen, there has to be some amount of voltage, since this is a, what is this, this is an electrically actuated valve, DCV, that means this is actually a solenoid here. Okay, so that means you require some amount of voltage, which will actually lead to the this solenoid getting energized, and then the spool will get shift, okay, towards this CC. Whenever you energize this using, okay, then what would happen, this would lead to your spool getting shifted, and your the left envelope, okay, that was your right now it was not energized, that will get engaged, and then hence that will lead to your extension of the cylinder. Okay, the moment you switch off the power supply, okay, that means this solenoid is not having any more power supply, that means whenever you will be pushing open this valve here, okay, or your push button circuit here, then what would happen, this solenoid would get again de-energized, and then your this valve would be put to its default position using this spring force, since it was a spring offset valve, and your cylinder would retract back. Okay, so in case of a double acting cylinder, what would be your electrically actuated DCV? It would again be, of course, 5x2, okay, or a 4x2, so because it requires two ports here, one pilot port, one or two drain port, depending upon what is the configuration of your valve, okay, and then again it has to be your solenoid operated in one case if it is a part of a electrically actuated DCV. Okay, in case of a pneumatic actuated, what was this, what would I name this valve as? I would have named as 5x2 spring offset pilot operate, single pilot operated DCV. In case of electro-pneumatic system, it would be 5x2 spring offset single solenoid actuated DCV. Okay, so if you see, this is again a solenoid which when actuated, okay, then what would happen, this envelope will get engaged and your cylinder would extend. Okay, and whenever this solenoid will get de-energized, okay, in case of no voltage here, okay, or if it does not have any control elements, okay, signal control elements coming here, then again your cylinder would retract back. Okay, so you get to see like where is the difference between your pneumatic and your electro-pneumatic circuit. So see, this is what is known as your power component, those will remain same in both the cases, okay, but your what would be an interface, your interface would be your final control element DCV, okay, which in case of an electro-pneumatic circuit would be actuated by a solenoid valve or a solenoid, okay, and in case of your pneumatic circuit it was operated by a pilot pressure, okay, and all your signal control elements, which in case of a pneumatic circuit was pneumatic signals. That means wherever you had any signal, you are only having your pressurized lines. Okay, you are doing all your control elements with that. In case of an electro pneumatic circuit, it will be an electrical signals. Okay, so I will stop here. Okay, for today's class.